talking about the ghetto. Funky, funky ghetto. Trying to survive, trying to stay alive.
This is a very interesting topic, okay, but like, you know, areas of cities or places around the country that have previously been occupied by certain socioeconomic group of people, class of people, that as new folks move in and kind of establish businesses there or livelihoods there, that it changes the neighborhood so that cost of living rises and that the original folks have to move out, and the landscape of the neighborhood or the city has changed in that way.
The migration of wealth, typically from Caucasian individuals into urban areas, that tends to displace lower income individuals, lower socioeconomic cultures. It's often associated with a change in culture, increased rents, increased property values, but a slow displacement of community and culture.
Well, what I know is that they remove like certain buildings and then they build something else on it, right? To make more profit.
I think there's various types of gentrification in the world. One being, of course, racial and cultural, but there's also economic and academic. And Oakland is facing all four. Probably another one that I didn't think of. Well, there's, yeah, so let's leave it at those four. And it has its pluses and its minuses.
Well, we studied like pros and cons, and well, we thought it was negative because we thought like more people would start moving in, and we don't think it's a bad thing, but then we thought like the community wasn't gonna be like the way it was.
The recent gentrification, I think, is a product of the recession, but I mean, it's very easy to see, you know, trust funds moving in and going ahead and swooping up huge swaths of land. And you have very few advocates that are able to go ahead and, you know, create any type of umbrella effect for those that need it the most. And in that way, it's ripe for such things to occur. I mean, it's not even to blind, or, you know, it definitely needs to be addressed. And so
that they were trying to remove a building from the school to build condos. That's what I remember. Yeah.
And what did you think about that?
I thought it was unfair, because if they really are using the building, then why would they tear it down to build something else?
I think, you know, one of the most telling examples actually has been the protests around Eric Garner's death and Mike Brown's death, because when I went out to the protests, I've been out a couple times, and I met a lot of people who have been doing protests around police brutality for years. You know, this one guy said he'd been doing it for 20 years since Rodney King, really, that he hadn't stopped, you know, and that was a kind of an issue that was like his life's work, you know. But he was telling me, he's like, I'd never seen this many people out on the street to protest this issue forever. He said, I've never heard people talking about it in the news this much. But he said that, you know, 20 years ago when the people were protesting in the streets in Oakland, that the group looked very, very different. And he said that it was almost 100% black people, people of color. And that now there's more people, but he said the majority, up until really, there was a couple events where we have a lot more people of color, but the majority of the protests have been young, you know, white folks. So, and that's been kind of like, for him, he was actually saying that was the moment that he knew, like, how much his city had changed. Because the issue, I mean, I think Oakland will always have a personality of, and the Bay Area has a personality of, like, you know, social justice and, like, you know, but movements that start here now, like Occupy and things like that, are much more dominated by young white people. So I think that was one of the first times that I realized how much, or what the real impact of something like gentrification is. You know, like, you see definitely businesses like this place, like, around us are changing, and but when you go and you see, like, it's not always like just like, that's why it's such a complicated issue. It's like, there's these folks moving in are seemingly great people, like, who care about their community, who want to, like, you know, make it better, and, like, care about a lot of the same issues that maybe the people who lived here before did. But definitely the faces are changing, and, like, and that has an impact too. I mean, that changes culture too. But I think, yeah, so that's one instance where I really noticed it.
It wasn't the people, it wasn't the neighborhood changing, like, the people who are already from here. It was the people coming from other states and other areas, and then, like, having an attitude towards the way Oakland already was. Thinking that it needed to be changed, like in certain ways that were just irritating to me. And then realizing, too, that rent and stuff was going up, because those people didn't know what was right to pay, what was wrong to pay. So, I mean, even right now, it's almost impossible to get an apartment by yourself. Like, you have to have a roommate or two or four.
You know, I'm concerned about the education, like a school like Tech, that now everybody wants to go to Tech. But still, the poor black kids are on the first floor and the white kids are on the second floor. And they get books, and the kids on the first floor don't even have books. So there's a difference in how people are treated. So I'm concerned about the education in that way, but I'm hopeful that it will. So sort of go across the board?
For sure there isn't like Caucasian people.
There isn't
at all. White people. There isn't.
What do you think about that?
Well, many of them do go to like the nicer areas in Oakland, like Tech and all that.
Yeah.
So I guess. I think downtown Oakland is like prettier than where I live in. It's like ugly.
I think education is an issue. I think academics for local high school youth is absolutely an issue. With students that I mentor that are in East Oakland, there's an enormous gap between the resources that they are allocated and the resources that would go to a high school like Oakland Tech, which is right down the street from me. An enormous discrepancy. So I think that's an issue. Like education is an issue, and as wealthy individuals move in, they flood the better schools and also suck up a lot of the resources.
When you look at 20 years ago, like the African American population in Oakland being twice what it is now. So like the identity of Oakland is essentially being lost overnight. Is that not
right? That's a huge, exactly.
But I do think it's a complicated issue because you know, I want to live in places where I can do the kind of work that I want to do, you know, and I want to be a part of the culture that was created here by the people who lived here, you know what I mean, who are from Oakland, like, and the Bay Area, and all these cities. Like, the reason people come to them is ultimately actually because the people who lived there, typically people of color, but whomever originally was there, they've created a culture that is attractive to people, and it's almost like you want to keep that going, you know. It's not like you come in to try to erase that culture. You actually want to be a part of it. But I think the danger is appropriation and, like, you know, forgetting who and not supporting the people who created the culture that brought you there, you know. And that's really what's hard, is that you want to do both at the same time. Like, you want to be a part of it, but you don't want to erase the actual people in it, you know.
When I was a kid, couldn't walk the lake at night, like, because there's crackheads, bums, and rapists. Now it's not a big deal. You can do shrooms at the lake now, and you're perfectly fine, which I found out. but especially the downtown area, over the years, watching the boards slowly come down off the building and stuff like that. And, watching the new bars and restaurants come up. Yeah. That was cool seeing that, but just remember, like, nothing was ever open. Like, nobody was out on the streets. Nobody was, like nobody cared. I don't know. Everybody was just, like, so anti. Like, everything in a way. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, like, if it was at nighttime and my dad was working, it's like I had to go get picked up because, like, it was a rough area. It was a rough neighborhood. I would have thought in a million years you'd have a little microbrewery place across the street. Like, I thought this community was going to sink. And whoever, I can't remember her name, but she owned it. She saw this place and she was like, no, like, we can do this. We can make this better. And she did it. And, like, now, like, there's so many people that walk through this neighborhood and they'll just stop in and business is getting better. And
I mean, the real estate is an issue. But besides that, it's far behind San Francisco. It's far behind Berkeley. I was born in Berkeley. I grew up here. I've been here my whole life. I do not feel comfortable being in Berkeley anymore. It's just too out there. It's, you know, totally gentrification in Berkeley. I feel comfortable in Oakland still. Hope to stay that way for a long time. I think it's going to take longer. There's enough people trying to watch out for Oakland.
I mean, I think I would love if cities themselves, whether it's Oakland, this is something there was a movement in San Francisco and the mission for this as well, but like, I think cities can designate areas as historical districts to prevent like complete annihilation of a history. You know, like I know that in Japantown in San Francisco, it's a different example, but they did that. Like they made it designated, this is going to be Japantown, so that we can preserve some of the culture here. That didn't necessarily make it affordable, so I don't know if that's a solution. But I do think that's one part of it, is that you don't want to walk into a place. You want the people who live there to feel like they're part of, that their history still matters, you know? Because there's two kinds of, I think, reasons, two ways that people are pushed out. There's the economic reason, but there's also like the cultural, you know, like, and one way to prevent the cultural one is to like make an effort to preserve the history of neighborhoods, however you can do that as a city or as a government, and even as people, like when you move in, like, you know, when you build a new business or whatnot, if you're going to build a new business, like how can you make sure that it's part of the community you're coming into and not like you imposing an aesthetic or an like idea on that community. But then I think also like economically, I think we can support local businesses that have been around for a long time. I mean, one interesting thing again during the protests is people were like, you know, there was some vandalism and there was some, things got a little out of hand at times, but you know, on Twitter, people made a concerted effort to pass around lists of, these are Black-owned businesses, these are businesses that have been in the area for a long time, and there was like lists you could see on Twitter and be like, if you're gonna, like, I'm not saying vandalize anything, but it's just an example of how like communities, like whatever they're doing, whenever you're doing it, there's a way to put like a framework around it, like be conscious of your environment and like the people who made it happen. And that was just one example of people coming together and being like, okay, if you're gonna be crazy, like just please avoid these places, you know? So I think that's something we can do in all of our lives, like when we shop and when we, you know, choose where to eat, things like that.
Well, I moved to Oakland a year ago, or should I say a year and a half ago. And one of the first things that I did when I moved in was research ways to get involved in the community and different opportunities to volunteer and help out. And I found, you know, a local nonprofit that works with disadvantaged and disengaged high school students. And it's a program of mentoring and entrepreneurship. But it was a way for me to feel like I was involved in the community and to feel like I was aware, and a way, honestly, to also learn about the community.
Oh, when you're fighting so many negative images of a place, of a location, you have to keep the focus on what's good about the city, what's good about Oakland, what's good about. And so we're doing some of that. I mean, we're pushing our new food scene, which is also causing some of the more positive gentrification. People are slowly and surely learning not to fear Oakland, not to avoid Oakland, not to say, ooh, you live in Oakland, type of thing.
I'm not worried. I think it makes Oakland look better. A year ago, I wouldn't have agreed, or I wouldn't have been so positive, but I think it's good for this city. Because I've always thought Oakland was the best city in the world. And I always thought to myself, even when I was in like middle school, I was like, why don't they try harder? Like, why don't they want people to like be proud of it? Just been some